1. And the Lord God said, It is not good for man to be alone, let us make him a helpmeet for him. Why, O prophet, is it not good for man to be alone? Because, says he, it is good that he who is alone should be alone. But God is alone, and by himself, being one, and there is nothing like unto God. So that, since it is good that he who only has a real existence should be alone, for that which is about itself alone is good, it cannot be good for man to be alone. 2. But the fact of God being alone one may receive in a sense, that neither before the creation was there anything with God, nor, since the world has been created, is anything placed in the same rank with him, for he is in need of absolutely nothing whatever. But the better way of understanding this passage is the following: God is alone, a single being, not a combination, a single nature, but each of us, and every other animal, in the world, are compound beings. For instance, I myself am made up of many things, of soul and body. Again, the soul is made up of a rational part, and an irrational part, also of the body. There is one part hot, another cold, one heavy, another light, one dry, another moist. But God is not a compound being, nor one which is made up of many parts, but one which has no mixture with anything else. 3. For whatever could be combined with God must be either superior to him, or inferior to him, or equal to him. But there is nothing equal to God, and nothing superior to him, and nothing is combined with him which is worse than himself, for if it were, he himself would be deteriorated, and if he were to suffer deterioration, he would also become perishable, which it is impious even to imagine. Therefore God exists according to oneness and unity, or we should rather say, that oneness exists according to the one God, for all number is more recent than the world, as is also time. But God is older than the world, and is its creator. 2. 4. But it is not good for any man to be alone. For there are two kinds of men, the one made according to the image of God, the other fashioned out of the earth, for it longs for its own likeness. For the image of God is the antitype of all other things, and every imitation aims at this of which it is the imitation, and is placed in the same class with it. And it is not good for either the man, who was made according to the image of God, to be alone, nor is it any more desirable for the factitious man to be alone, and indeed it is impossible. For the external senses, and the passions, and the vices, and innumerable other things, are combined with and adapted to the mind of this man. 5. But the second kind of man has a helpmeet for him, who, in the first place, is created, for I will make him, says God, a helpmeet for him. And, in the second place, is younger than the object to be helped, for, first of all, God created the mind, and subsequently he prepares to make its helper. But all this is spoken allegorically, in accordance with the principles of natural philosophy, for external sensation, and the passions of the soul are all younger than the soul, and how they help it we shall see hereafter, but at present we will consider the fact of their being helpers younger than the object helped. 3. 6. As, according to the most skillful physicians and natural philosophers, the heart appears to be formed before the rest of the body, after the manner of the foundation of a house, or the keel of a ship, and then the rest of the body is built upon it, on which account, even after death, the physicians say, that the heart still quivers, as having been created before the rest of the body, and being destroyed after it. So also does the dominant portion of the soul appear to be older than the whole of the soul, and the irrational part, to be younger, the formation of which Moses has not yet mentioned, but he is about to give a sketch of it, how the irrational part of the soul as the external sensation, and the passions which spring from it, especially if the judgments are our own. And this assistant of God is younger, and created, being thus described with perfect propriety. 7. But now let us see how that part, which was postponed before, acts, as an assistant. How does our mind comprehend that such and such a thing is black or white, unless it employs sight as its assistant? And how does it know that the voice of the man, who is singing to his harp is sweet, or, on the contrary, out of tune, if it has not the assistance of the faculty of hearing to guide it? And how can it tell that exhalations are fragrant, or foul-smelling, unless it makes use of the sense of smell, as its sally? How again does it judge of the different flavors, except through the instrumentality of its assistant, taste? 8. How can it distinguish between what is rough and what is smooth, except by touch? There is also another class of assistants, as I have already said, namely, the passions, for pleasure also is an assistant, cooperating towards the durability of our race, and in like manner concupiscence, and pain, and fear, biting the soul, lead it to treat nothing with indifference. Anger, again, is a defensive weapon, which has been of great service to many people, and so too have the other passions, in the same manner. On which account Moses has said, with great felicity, that he was an assistant to himself, for he is in reality an assistant to the mind, as if he were its brother, and near kinsman, for the external sensations, and the passions are parts of one soul, and are its offspring. 4. 9. Now of assistants there are two kinds, the one consisting in the passions, and the other in the sensations. 1. A word or two are lost here. 5. For thinks that several sentences are wanting, and there is a great want of connection between what follows, and what has gone before, but the prior kind is that of generation. For Moses says, And God proceeded, and made all the beasts of the field out of the earth, and all the birds of heaven, and he brought them to Adam, to see what he would call them, and whatever Adam called any living soul, that became its name. You see here who are our assistants, the beasts of the soul, the passions. For after God has said, I will make him a helpmeet for him, Moses said subsequently, He made the beasts, as if the beasts also were assistants, to us, 10, but these are not, properly speaking, assistants, but are called so only in a catechistic manner, by a kind of abuse of language, for they are found in reality to be enemies to man. As also in the case of cities, the allies turn out at times to be traitors and deserters, and in the case of friendship, flatterers are found to be enemies instead of companions, and Moses here speaks of the heaven and the field synonymously, describing the mind in this allegorical manner, for the mind, like the field, has innumerable periods of rising and budding forth, and, like the heaven, has brilliant and divine and happy characteristics of nature. 11. But the passions he compares to beasts and birds, because they injure the mind, being untamed and wild, and because, after the manner of birds, they descend upon the intellect, for their onset is swift and difficult to withstand, and the word besides, as attached to he made, is not superfluous. Why so? Because he has previously said, that the beasts were formed before the creation of man, and he shows it in the following words, which are an account of what was done on the sixth day. And God said, Let the earth bring forth living creatures, after their kind, four-footed animals, and creeping things, and wild beasts. 12. Why, then, is it that he makes other animals now, not being content with those already existing? Now this must be stated according to the principles of moral philosophy. The species of evil are abundant in created man, so that the most evil things are continually produced in him, and this other thing must be affirmed on principles of natural philosophy. First of all, in the 6 days he created the different kinds of passions, and the ideas, but now, in addition to them, he is creating the species. 13. On which account Moses says, And, besides he made, and that what had been previously created were genera is plain from what he says, Let the earth bring forth living souls, not according to species, but according to genus. And this is found to be the course taken by God, in all cases, for before making the species he completes the genera, as he did in the case of man, for having first modeled the generic man, in whom they say that the male and female sexes are contained, he afterwards created the specific man Adam. V. 14. This therefore he denominated the species of assistants, but the other part of the creation, the description, that is, of the formation of the external sensations, was postponed till he began to form the woman, and having put off this he then gives an account of the distribution of names, and this is an explanation, partly figurative, and partly literal, which is worthy of our admiration. It is literal, inasmuch as the lawgiver has attributed the imposition of names to the firstborn man. 15. For those also among the Greeks, who study philosophy, say that they were wise men, who first gave names to things. But Moses speaks more correctly in the first place, because he attributes this giving of names, not to some of those men, who lived in early times, but to the first man, who was created upon the earth, so that, just as he himself was created to be the beginning of creation, to all other animals, he might also be considered the beginning of conversation and language, for if there were no such things as names there could be no such thing as language, and, secondly, because, if many different persons gave names, they must have been different and devoid of all connection, since different persons would have given different names, but if only one person did so, the name given by one was sure to be adapted to the thing, and the same name was likely to be a token to every one of the existing things signified by it. 6. 16. But the moral meaning of this passage is, as follows. We often use the expression tea instead of deity. Why? As when we say, why, tea, have you washed yourself? Why, tea, are you walking? Why, tea, are you conversing? For in all these cases tea is used instead of deity, when therefore Moses says, to see what he would call them, you must understand him, as if he had said deity, why, instead of tea, what, and the mind will invite and embrace each of these meanings. Is it then only for the sake of what is necessary that the mortal race is of necessity implicated in passions and vices? Or is it also on account of that which is immoderate and superfluous? And again, is it because of the requirements of the earth-born man, or because the mind judges them to be most excellent and admirable things? 17. As for instance, is it necessary for every created thing to enjoy pleasure? But the bad man flies to pleasure as to a perfect good, but the good man seeks it only as necessary, for without pleasure nothing whatever is done among the human race. Again, the bad man considers the acquisition of riches as the most perfect good possible, but the good man looks upon riches only as necessary and useful thing. 18. Very naturally, therefore, God desires to see and to learn how the mind denominates and appreciates each of these things, whether it looks upon them as good, or as things indifferent, or as evil in themselves, but nevertheless in some respects necessary. On which account, thinking that everything which he invited towards himself, and embraced, as a living soul, was of equal value and importance with the soul, this became the name, not only of the thing which was thus invited, but also of him, who invited it. As for instance, if the man embraced pleasure, he was called a man devoted to pleasure. If he embraced appetite, he was called a man of appetite. If he invited intemperance, he himself also acquired the name of intemperate. If he admitted cowardice, he was called cowardly, and so on in the case of the other passions. For as he who has any distinctive qualities according to the virtues is called from that virtue with which he is especially endowed, prudent, or temperate, or just, or courageous, as the case may be, so too in respect of the vices, a man is called unjust, or foolish, or unmanly, when he has invited and embraced these habits of mind and conduct. 7. 19. And God cast a deep trance upon Adam, and sent him to sleep, and he took one of his ribs, and so on. The literal statement conveyed in these words is a fabulous one, for how can anyone believe that a woman was made of a rib of a man, or, in short, that any human being was made out of another? And what hindered God, as he had made man out of the earth, from making woman, in the same manner? For the Creator was the same, and the material was almost interminable, from which every distinctive quality whatever was made. And why, when there were so many parts of a man, did not God make the woman out of some other part rather than out of one of his ribs? Again, of which rib did he make her? And this question would hold even if we were to say that he had only spoken of two ribs, but in truth he has not specified their number. Was it then the right rib or the left rib? 20. Again, if he filled up the place of the other with flesh, was not the one which he left also made of flesh? And indeed our ribs are like sisters, and akin in all their parts, and they consist of flesh. What then are we to say? 21. Ordinary custom calls the ribs the strength of a man, for we say that a man has ribs, which is equivalent to saying that he has vigor, and we say that a wrestler is a man with strong ribs, when we mean to express that he is strong, and we say that a harp player has ribs, instead of saying that he has energy and power in his singing. 22. Now that this has been premised, we must also say that the mind, while naked and free from the entanglement of the body, for our present discussion is about the mind, while it is as yet entangled in nothing, has many powers, namely, the possessive power, the progenitive power, the power of the soul, the power of reason, the power of comprehension, and part of others innumerable both in their genus and species. Now the possessive power is common to it with other inanimate things, with stocks and stones, and it is shared by the things in us, which are like stones, namely, by our bones. And natural power extends also over plants, and there are parts in us which have some resemblance to plants, namely, our nails, and our hair. 23. And nature is a habit already put in motion, but the soul is a habit which has taken to itself, in addition, imagination, and impetuosity, and this power also is possessed by man in common with the irrational animals, and our mind has something analogous to the soul of any rational animal. Again, the power of comprehension is a peculiar property of the mind, and the reasoning power is perhaps common to the more divine natures, but is especially the property of the mortal nature of man, and this is a twofold power, one kind being that in accordance with which we are rational creatures, partaking of mind, and the other kind being that faculty by which we converse. 24. There is also another power in the soul akin to these, the power of sensation, of which we are now speaking. For Moses is describing nothing else on this occasion except the formation of the external sense, according to energy, and according to reason. 8. For immediately after the creation of the mind it was necessary that the external sense should be created, as an assistant and ally of the mind, therefore God having entirely perfected the first, proceeded to make the second, both in rank and power, being a certain created form, an external sense according to energy, created for the perfection and completion of the whole soul, and for the proper comprehension of such subject matter, as might be brought before it. 25. How then was the second thing created? As Moses himself says in a subsequent passage, when the mind was gone to sleep, for, in real fact, the external sense then comes forward when the mind is asleep. And again, when the mind is awake the outward sense is extinguished, and the proof of this is, that when we desire to form an accurate conception of anything, we retreat to a desert place, we shut our eyes, we stop up our ears, we discard the exercise of our senses, and so, when the mind rises up again and awakens, the outward sense is put an end to. 26. Let us now consider another point, namely, how the mind goes to sleep, for when the outward sense is awakened, and has become excited, when the sight beholds any works of painting, or of sculpture beautifully wrought, is not the mind then without anything on which to exercise its functions, contemplating nothing which is a proper subject for the intellect? What more? When the faculty of hearing is attending to some melodious combination of sound, can the mind turn itself to the contemplation of its proper objects? By no means. And it is much more destitute of occupation, when taste rises up and eagerly devotes itself to the pleasures of the belly. 27. On which account Moses, being alarmed lest some day, or other the mind might not merely go to sleep, but might become absolutely dead, says in another place, "And it shall be to you a peg in your girdle, and it shall be, that when you sit down you shall dig in it, and, heaping up earth, shall cover your shame." 2:23-13 period, speaking symbolically, and giving the name of peg to reason which digs up secret affairs. 28. And he bids him to bear it upon the affection with which he ought to be burdened, and not to allow it to slacken and become loosened. And this must be done when the mind, departing from the intense consideration of objects perceptible by the intellect, is brought down to the passions, and sits down, yielding to, and being guided by, the necessities of the body. 29. And this is the case, when the mind, being absorbed in luxurious associations, forgets itself, being subdued by the things which conduct it to pleasure, and so we become enslaved, and yield ourselves up to unconcealed impurity. But if reason be able to purify the passion, then, neither when we drink do we become intoxicated, nor when we eat do we become indolent through satiety, but we feast soberly without indulging in folly. 30. Therefore, the awakening of the outward senses is the sleep of the mind, and the awakening of the mind is the discharge of the outward senses from all occupation. Just as when the sun arises the brightness of all the rest of the stars becomes invisible, but when the sun sets, they are seen. And so, like the sun, the mind, when it is awakened, overshadows the outward senses, but when it goes to sleep it permits them to shine. 9. 31. After this preface we must now proceed to explain the words, "The Lord God," says Moses, "cast a deep trance upon Adam, and sent him to sleep." He speaks here with great correctness, for a trance and perversion of the mind is its sleep. And the mind is rendered beside itself, when it ceases to be occupied about the things perceptible only by the intellect which present themselves to it. And when it is not energizing with respect to them it is asleep. And the expression, "it is in a trance," is very well employed, as it means that it is perverted and changed, not by itself, but by God, who presents to it, and brings before it, and sends upon it the change which occurs to it. 32. For the case is this: if it were in my own power to be changed, then whenever I chose I should exercise this power, and whenever I did not choose I should continue, as I am, without any change. but now change attacks me from an opposite direction, and very often when I am desirous to turn my intellect to some fitting subject, I am swallowed up by an influx contrary to what is fitting, and on the other hand, when I conceive an idea respecting something unseemly, I discard it by means of pleasant notions, while God, by His own grace, pours into my soul a sweet stream instead of the salt flood. 33. It is necessary, therefore, that every created thing should at times be changed. For this is a property of every created thing, just as it is an attribute of God, to be unchangeable. But of these beings who have been changed, some remain in their altered state till their final and complete destruction, though others are only exposed to the ordinary vicissitudes of human nature, and they are immediately preserved. 34. On which account Moses says that God will not suffer the destroyer to enter into your houses, to smite them 3 Ex 12:23:4. He does permit the destroyer, and changes the destruction of the soul, to enter into the soul, in order to exhibit the peculiar characteristic of the created being. But God will not permit the offspring of the seeing Israel, to be changed in such a manner, as to be stricken down by the change. But He will compel it to emerge and rise up again like one who rises up from the deep, and so He will cause it to be saved. Ex 35. He took one of His ribs. He took one of the many powers of the mind, namely, that power which dwells in the outward senses. And when He uses the expression, "He took," we are not to understand it as if He had said, "He took away," but rather as equivalent to "He counted, He examined," as He says in another place, "Take the chief of the spoils of the captivity." 4 Psalm 31:26. What, then, is it which He wishes to show? 36. Sensation is spoken of in a twofold manner, the one kind being according to habit, which exists even when we are asleep, and the other being according to energy. Now, in the former kind, the one according to habit, there is no use, for we do not comprehend any one of the objects presented to our view by its means. But there is use in the second, in that which exists according to energy, for it is by means of this that we arrive at a comprehension of the objects perceptible by the outward senses. 37. Accordingly, God, having created the former kind of sensation, that existing according to habit, when He was creating the mind, for He was furnishing that with many faculties, in a state of rest, desires now to complete the other kind which exists according to energy. And this one according to energy is perfected when the one which exists according to habit is put in motion, and extended as far as the flesh and the organs of sense. For as nature is perfected when the seed is put in motion, so, also, energy is perfected when the habit is put in motion. 11. 38. And He filled the space with flesh instead of it. That is to say, He filled up that external sense which exists according to habit, leading it onto energy, and extending it as far as the flesh and the whole outward and visible surface of the body. In reference to which Moses says that He built it up into a woman, showing by this expression that woman is the most natural and felicitously given name for the external sense. For as the man is seen in action, and the woman in being the subject of action, so also is the mind seen in action, and the external sense, like the woman, is discerned by suffering or being the subject of action. 39. And it is easy to learn this from the way in which it is affected in practice. Thus the sight is affected by these objects of sight which put it in motion, such as white and black, and the other colors. Again, hearing is affected by sounds, and taste is disposed in such or such a way by flavors, the sense of smell by sense, and that of touch by hardness or softness. And, on the other hand, all the outward senses are in a state of tranquility, until each is approached from without by that which is to put it in motion. 12. 40. And He brought her to Adam. And Adam said, "This is now bone of my bone, and flesh of my flesh." God leads the external sense, existing according to energy, to the mind, knowing that its motion and apprehension must turn back to the mind. But the mind, perceiving the power which it previously had, and which, while it was existing according to habit, was in a state of tranquility, now have to become a complete operation and energy, and to be in a state of motion, marvels at it, and utters an exclamation, saying that it is not unconnected with it, but very closely akin to it. 41. For Adam says, "This now is bone of my bone," that is to say, "This is power of my power," for bone is here to be understood as a symbol of strength and power. And it is, he adds, "suffering of my sufferings," that is, "it is flesh of my flesh." For everything which the external sense suffers, it endures not without the support of the mind, for the mind is its fountain, and the foundation on which it is supported. 42. It is also worthwhile to consider why Adam added the word now, for he says, "This now is bone of my bone." The explanation is, external sensation exists now, having its existence solely with reference to the present moment. For the mind touches three separate points of time, for it perceives present circumstances, and it remembers past events, and it anticipates the future. 43. But the external sensations have neither any anticipation of future events, nor are they subject to any feeling resembling expectation nor hope, nor have they any recollection of past circumstances, but are by nature capable only of being affected by that which moves them at the moment, and is actually present. As, for example, the eye is made white by a white appearance presented to it at the moment, but it is not affected in any manner by that which is not present to it. But the mind is agitated also by that which is not actually present, but which may be past, in which case it is affected by its recollection of it, or it may be future, in which case it is, indeed, the influence of hope and expectation. 13. 44. And she shall be called woman. This is equivalent to saying, on this account the outward sensation shall be called woman, because it is derived from man, who sets it in motion. He says she, why, then, is the expression she used? Why, because there is also another kind of outward sensation, not derived from the mind, but having been created, at the same moment with it. For there are, as I have said before, two different kinds of outward sensation, the one kind existing according to habit, and the other according to energy. 45. Now, the kind existing according to habit is not derived from the man, that is to say from the mind, but is created at the same time with him. For the mind, as I have already shown, when it was created with many faculties and habits, namely, with the faculty and habit of reasoning, and of existing, and of promoting what is like itself, as also with that of receiving impressions from the outward senses. But the outward sensation, which exists according to energy, is derived from the mind. For it is extended from the outward sensation which exists in it according to habit, so, as to become the same outward sense according to energy. So that the second kind of outward sense is derived from the mind, and exists according to motion. 46. And he is but a foolish person, who thinks that anything is in true reality made out of the mind, or out of itself. Do you not see that even in the case of Rachel, that is to say of outward sensation, sitting upon the images, while she thought that her motions came from the mind, he who saw her reproved her? For she says, "Give me my children, and if you give them not to me I shall die." 5 pounds 31. And he replied, "Because, O mistaken woman, the mind is not the cause of anything, but he which existed before the mind, namely God." On which account he adds, "Am I equal to God, who has deprived you of the fruit of your womb?" 47. But that it is God, who creates man, he will testify in the case of Leah, when he says, "But the Lord, when he saw that Leah was hated, opened her womb." But Rachel was barren. 6 pounds 29. But it is the especial property of men to open the womb. Now naturally virtue is hated by men. On which account God has honored it, and gives the honor of bearing the first child to her, who is hated. 48. And in another passage he says, "But, if a man has two wives, one of them being loved, and one of them being hated, and if they bear him children, and if the firstborn son be the child of her, who is hated, he will not be able to give the honors of the birthright to the child of the wife, whom he loves." Overlooking the firstborn son the child of her, who is hated. 7 pounds 21. For the productions of virtue which is hated, are the first and the most perfect, but those of pleasure, which is loved, are the last. 14. 49. On this account a man will leave his father, and his mother, and will cleave to his wife, and they two shall become one flesh. On account of the external sensation, the mind, when it has become enslaved to it, shall leave both its father, the God, of the universe, and the mother of all things, namely, the virtue and wisdom of God, and cleaves to, and becomes united to the external sensations, and is dissolved into external sensation, so that the two become one flesh, and one passion. 50. And here you must observe that it is not the woman who cleaves to the man, but on the contrary, the man who cleaves to the woman, that is to say, the mind cleaves to the external sensations. For when that which is the better, namely, the mind, is united to that which is the rose, namely, the external sensation, it is then dissolved into the nature of flesh, which is worse, and into outward sensation, which is the cause of the passions. But when that which is the inferior, namely, the outward sensation, follows the better part, that is the mind, then there will no longer be flesh, but both will become one, namely, mind. And this is a thing of such a nature, that it prefers the affections to piety. 51. There is also another being called by an opposite name, Levi, he who says to his father and mother, He saw you not, and he did not recognize his brethren, and repudiated his children. 8:33. This man leaves his father and mother, that is to say, his mind, and the material of his body, in order to have as his inheritance the one God. For the Lord himself is his inheritance. 9:10. 9:52. And, indeed, suffering is the inheritance of him who is fond of suffering, but the inheritance of Levi's God. Do you not see that he bids him on the tenth day of the month bring two goats, as his share, one lot, for the Lord, and one lot, for the scapegoat. 10:16. 7:7. For the sufferings inflicted on the scapegoat are in real truth the lot of him who is fond of suffering. 15:53. And they were both naked, both Adam and his wife, and they were not ashamed, but the serpent was the most subtle of all the beasts that were upon the earth, which the Lord God had made. 11:25. 3:1. The mind is naked, which is clothed neither with vice nor with virtue, but which is really stripped of both, just as the soul of an infant child, which has no share in either virtue or vice, is stripped of all coverings, and is completely naked, for these things are the coverings of the soul, by which it is enveloped and concealed, good being the garment of the virtuous soul, and evil the robe of the wicked soul. 54. And the soul is made naked in these ways. Once, when it is in an unchangeable state, and is entirely free from all vices, and has discarded and laid aside the covering of all the passions. With reference to this, Moses also pitches his tabernacle outside of the camp, a long way from the camp, and it was called the Tabernacle of Testimony. 12:7. 55. And this has some such meaning, as this: the soul which loves God, having put off the body, and the affections which are dear to it, and having fled a long way from them, chooses a foundation, and a sure ground for its abode, and a lasting settlement in the perfect doctrines of virtue, on which account testimony is borne to it by God, that it loves what is good, for it was called the Tabernacle of Testimony, says Moses, and he has passed over in silence the giver of the name, in order that the soul, being excited, might consider who it is who thus beareth witness to the dispositions which love virtue. 56. On this account the high priest will not come into the Holy of Holies clad in a garment reaching to the feet, 13:16. 1. But having put off the robe of opinion, and vain fancy of the soul, and having left that for those who love the things which are without, and who honor opinion in preference to truth, will come forward naked, without colors, or any sounds, to make an offering of the blood of the soul, and to sacrifice the whole mind to God the Savior and Benefactor. 57. And certainly Nadab and Abihu, 14:1, who came near to God, and left this mortal life, and received a share of immortal life, are seen to be naked, that is, free from all new and mortal opinion, for they would not have carried it in their garments, and borne it about, if they had not been naked, having broken to pieces every bond of passion, and of corporeal necessity, in order that their nakedness and absence of corporeality might not be adulterated by the accession of atheistical reasonings, for it may not be permitted to all men to behold the secret mysteries of God, but only to those who are able to cover them up and guard them. 58. On which account Mishael and his partisans concealed them not in their own garments, but in those of Nadab and Abihu, who had been burnt with fire, and taken upwards, for having stripped off all the garments that covered them, they brought their nakedness before God, and left their tunics about Mishael. But clothes belong to the irrational part of the animal, which overshadow the rational part. Abraham also was naked when he heard, 59, Come forth out of thy land, and from thy kindred, 15:13. 1. And as for Isaac, he indeed was not stripped, but was at all times naked and incorporeal, for a commandment was given to him not to go down into Egypt, 16:26. 2. That is to say, into the body. Jacob also was fond of the nakedness of the soul, for his smoothness is nakedness, for Esau was a hairy man, but Jacob, says Moses, was a smooth man. 17 pounds sign GE 25-25 period, on which account he was also the husband of Leah. 16. 60. This is the most excellent nakedness, but the other nakedness is of a contrary nature, being a change which involves a deprivation of virtue, when the soul becomes foolish and goes astray. Such was the folly of Noah, when he was naked, when he drank wine 18 pounds sign GE 9-21 period. But thanks be to God, that this change, and this stripping naked of the mind according to the deprivation of virtue, did not extend as far as external things, but remained in the house, for Moses says, that he was stripped naked in his house, for even if a wise man does commit folly, he still does not run to ruin like a bad man. For the evil of the one is spread abroad, but that of the other is kept within bounds, and therefore he becomes sober again, that is to say, he repents, and, as it were, recovers from his disease. 61. But let us now more accurately examine the statement, that the stripping of him naked took place in his house. When the soul, being changed, only conceives some evil thing, and does not put it in execution, so as to accomplish it indeed, then the sin is only in the private domain and abode of the soul. But if, in addition to thinking some wickedness, it proceeds also to accomplish it, and carry it into execution, then the wickedness is diffused over the parts beyond his house. 62. And on this account he curses Canaan also, because he related the change of his soul abroad. That is to say, he extended it into the parts out of doors, and gave it notoriety, adding to his evil intention and evil consummation by means of his actions. But Shem and Japhet are praised, because they did not attack his soul, but rather concealed its deterioration. 63. On this account also the prayers and vows of the soul are invalidated when they are made in the house of one's father, or one's husband. 19 pounds sign GE 25-25 period, while the reasoning powers are in a state of quiescence, and do not attack the alteration which has taken place in a soul, but conceal the delinquency, for then also the master of all things will purify it. But he hears the prayer of the widow, and of her, who is divorced, without revoking it, for whatever, says he, she has vowed against her own soul shall abide to her, and very reasonably, for if, after she has been put away, she has advanced as far as the parts out of the house, so that not only is her place changed, but that she also sins in respect of deeds that she has perfected, she remains incurable, having no communion of conversation with her husband, and being deprived also of the advocacy and consolation of her father. 64. The third description of stripping naked is the middle one, according to which the mind is destitute of reason, having no share in either virtue or vice, and it is with reference to this kind of nakedness which an infant also is partaker of, that the expression is used which says, "And the two were naked, both Adam and his wife," and the meaning of it is this: neither did their intellect understand, nor did their outward senses perceive this nakedness. But the former was devoid of all power of understanding, and naked, and the latter was destitute of all perception. 17. 65. And the expression, "they were not ashamed," we will examine hereafter, for there are three ideas brought forward in this passage: shamelessness, modesty, and a state of indifference, in which one is neither shameless nor modest. Now shamelessness is the property of a worthless person, and modesty the characteristic of a virtuous one, but the state of being neither modest nor shameless is a sign of a person who is void of comprehension, and who does not act from any settled opinion, and it is of such a one that we are now speaking, for he, who has not yet acquired any comprehension of good or evil, is not able to be either shameless or modest. 66. Therefore the examples of shamelessness are all the unseemly pieces of conduct, when the mind reveals disgraceful things, while it ought rather to cover them in the shade, instead of which it boasts of and glories in them. It is said also in the case of Miriam, when she was speaking against Moses, "If her father had spit in her face, ought she not to keep herself retired for 7 days 20 pounds sign new 12-14 period 67, for the external sense, being really shameless and impudent, though considered as nothing by God the Father, in comparison of him, who was faithful in all his house, to whom God himself united the Ethiopian woman, that is to say, unchangeable and well-satisfied opinion, dared to speak against Moses and to accuse him, for the very actions for which he deserved to be praised, for this is his greatest praise, that he received the Ethiopian woman, the unchangeable nature, tried in the fire, and found honest, for as in the eye, the part which sees is black, so also the part of the soul which seizes what is meant by the Ethiopian woman. 68. Why when, as there are many works of wickedness, does he mention one only, namely, that which is conversant about what is shameful, saying, they were not ashamed but were they not doing wrong, or were they not sinning, or were they not acting indecorously? But the cause is at hand. No, by the only true God, I think nothing so shameful as to suppose that I comprehend with my intellect, or perceive by my outward sense. 69. Is my mind the cause of my comprehending? How so? For does it even comprehend itself, and know what it is, or how it came to exist? And are the outward senses the cause of man's perceiving anything? How can it be said to be so, when it is neither understood by itself nor by the mind? Do you not see that he who fancies that he comprehends is often found to be foolish in his acts of covetousness, in his drunkenness, in his deeds of folly? Where then is his intellectual capacity shown in these actions? Again, is not the outward sensation often deprived of the power of exercising itself? Are there not times when seeing we do not see, and hearing we do not hear, when the mind has its attention ever so little drawn off to some other object of the intellect, and is applied to the consideration of that? 70. As long as they are both naked, the mind naked of its power of exciting the intellect, and the outward sense of its power of sensation, they have nothing disgraceful in them, but the moment that they begin to display any comprehension, they become masked in shame and insolence, for they will often be found behaving with simplicity and folly rather than with any sound knowledge, and this not only in particular acts of covetousness, or spleen, or folly, but also in the general conduct of life. For when the outward sense has the dominion, the mind is enslaved, giving its attention to no one proper object of its intellect, and when the mind is predominant, the untoward senses seem to be without employment, having no comprehension of any proper object of its own exercise. 18. 71. Now the serpent was the most subtle of all the beasts which are upon the earth, which the Lord God made 21 sign GE 31 period two things having been previously created, that is, mind, and outward sense, and these also having been stripped naked in the manner which has already been shown. It follows of necessity that pleasure, which brings these two together, must be the third, for the purpose of facilitating the comprehension of the objects of intellect, and of outward sense. For neither could the mind, without the outward sense, be able to comprehend the nature of any animal, or of any plant, or of a stone, or of a piece of wood, or, in short, of any substance whatever, nor could the outward sense exercise its proper faculties, without the mind. 72. Since, therefore, it was necessary for both these things to come together for the due comprehension of these objects, what was it which brought them together except a third something which acted as a bond between them, the two first representing love and desire, and pleasure not obtaining the dominion and mastery, which pleasure Moses here speaks of symbolically, under the emblem of the serpent? 73. God, who created all the animals on the earth, arranged this order very admirably, for he placed the mind first, that is to say, man, for the mind is the most important part in man, then outward sense, that is the woman, and then proceeding in regular order he came to the third, pleasure. But the powers of these three, and their ages, are different only in the night, for in point of time they are equal, for the soul brings forward everything at the same moment with itself, but some things it brings forward in their actuality, and others in their power of existing, even if they have not yet arrived at the end. 74. And pleasure has been represented under the form of the serpent, for this reason, as the motion of the serpent is full of many windings, and varied, so also is the motion of pleasure. At first it folds itself round a man in five ways, for the pleasures consist both in seeing, and in hearing, and in taste, and in smell, and in touch. But the most vehement and intense are those which arise from connection with woman, through which the generation of similar beings is appointed by nature to be affected. 75. And yet this is not the only reason why we say that pleasure is various in appearance, namely, because it folds itself around all the divisions of the irrational part of the soul, but because it also folds itself with many windings around each separate part. For instance, the pleasures derived from sight are various. There is all the pleasure which arises from the contemplation of pictures or statues, and all other works which are made by art delight the sight. So also do the different stages through which plants go while budding and flowering, and bearing fruit, and likewise the diversified beauty of the different animals. In the same manner the flute gives pleasure to the sense of hearing, as does the harp, and every kind of instrument, and the harmonious voices of the irrational animals, of swallows, of nightingales, and likewise the melody of such rational beings as nature has made musical, the tuneful voice of the harp players, and of those who represent comedy, or tragedy, or any other histrionic performance. 19. 76. Why need we enlarge on the pleasures of the belly? For we may almost say that there are as many varieties of pleasure as there are of gentle flavors which are presented to the belly, and which excite the outward sense. Was it not then, with great propriety that pleasure, which is derived from many varied sources, was presented to an animal endowed with varied faculties? 77. On this account, too, that part in us which is analogous to the people, and which acts the part of a multitude, when it seeks the houses in Egypt, 22 pounds 21.5, that is to say, in its corporeal habitation, becomes entangled in pleasures which bring on death, not that death which is a separation of soul and body, but that which is the destruction of the soul by vice. For Moses says, And the Lord God sent among the people deadly serpents, and they bit the people, and a great multitude of the children of Israel died 23 pounds 21.6, 4. In real truth there is nothing which so much bringing its death upon the soul, as an immoderate indulgence in pleasures. 78. And that which perishes is not the dominant portion in us, but the subject one, that which acts the part of the multitude, and it receives death up to this point, namely, until it turns to repentance, and confesses its sin, for the Israelites, coming to Moses, say, We have sinned in that we have spoken against the Lord, and against you, pray. Therefore, for us to the Lord, and let him take away the serpents from us, it is well put here. Not we have sinned, because we have spoken against the Lord, but, because we were inclined to sin we have spoken against the Lord, for when the mind sins, and departs from virtue, it blames divine things, imputing its own sins to God. 20.79. How, then, can there be any remedy for this evil? When another serpent is created, the enemy of the serpent which came to Eve, namely, the word of temperance, for temperance is opposite to pleasure, which is a varied evil, being a varied virtue, and one ready to repel its enemy pleasure. Accordingly, God commands Moses to make the serpent according to temperance, and he says, Make thyself a serpent, and set it up for a sign. Do you see that Moses makes the serpent for no one else but for himself? For God commands him, Make it for thyself, in order, that you may know that temperance is not the gift of every one, but only of that man, who loves God. 80. And we must consider why Moses makes a brazen serpent, when no command was given to him respecting the material of which it was to be formed. May it not have been for this reason? In the first place, the graces of God are immaterial, being themselves only ideas, and destitute of any distinctive quality, but the graces of mortal men are only beheld in connection with matter. In the second place, not only does Moses love the incorporeal virtues, but our own souls, not being able to put off their bodies, do likewise aim at corporeal virtue. 81. And reason, in accordance with temperance, is likened to the strong and solid substance of brass, inasmuch as it is firm, and not easily cut through. And perhaps brass may also have been selected inasmuch as temperance in the man, who loves God is a most honorable thing, and like gold, though it has only a secondary place, in a man, who has received wisdom, and improved in it. And whomsoever the one serpent bites, if he looks upon the brazen serpent shall live in which Moses speaks truly, for if the mind, that has been bitten by pleasure, that is by the serpent which was sent to Eve, shall have strength, to behold the beauty of temperance, that is to say, the serpent made by Moses, in a manner affecting the soul, and to behold God himself through the medium of the serpent, it shall live. Only let it see, and contemplate it intellectually. 21. 82. Do you not see that wisdom, when dominant, which is Sarah, says, For whosoever shall hear it shall rejoice with me 24 pounds 21.6, but suppose that any were able to hear that virtue has brought forth happiness, namely, Isaac, immediately he will sing a congratulatory hymn. As, therefore, it can only be one, who has heard the news, that can sympathize in one's joy, so also it can only be he, who has clearly seen temperance and God, who is safe from death. 83. But many souls that have been in love with perseverance and temperance, when removed to a distance from the passions, have nevertheless withstood the power of God, and have undergone a change for the worse, while their master has made a display of himself and of the work of creation, of himself, that he is always immovable, and of the work of creation, that it vibrates, as if in a scale, and inclines opposite ways at different times. 84. For Moses speaks to the Israelites of God, who led ye them through that great and terrible wilderness, where there were biting serpents, and scorpions, and thirst, where there was no water. Who brought forth for thee out of the hard rock a fountain of water. Who fed thee with manna in the desert, which thy fathers knew not. 25:8-14 period. Do you not see that not only did the soul, while longing for the passions which prevailed in Egypt, fall under the power of the serpents, but that, also, while it was in the wilderness, it was bitten by pleasure, that affection of varied and serpent-like appearance. And the work of pleasure has received a most appropriate name, for it is called abiding. 85. Moreover, not only they who were in the desert were bitten by serpents, but also they who were scattered abroad. For I, also, often having left the men who were my kinsmen, and my friends, and my country, and having gone into the desert in order that I might perceive some of those things which are worthy of being beheld, have profited nothing. But my mind, being separated from me, or being bitten by passion, has withdrawn towards the things opposite to them. And there are times when in the midst of a multitude composed of infinite numbers of men, I can bring my mind into solitude, God having scattered for me the crowd which perplexes my soul, and having taught me that it is not the difference of place that is the cause of good and evil, but rather God, who moves and drives this vehicle of the soul wherever he pleases. 86. Moreover, the soul falls in with a scorpion, that is to say, with dispersion, in the wilderness, and the thirst, which is that of the passions, seizes on it until God sends forth upon it the stream of his own accurate wisdom, and causes the changed soul to drink of unchangeable health. For the abrupt rock is the wisdom of God, which being both sublime and the first of things he quarried out of his own powers. And of it he gives drink to the souls that love God, and they, when they have drunk, are also filled with the most universal manna, for manna is called something which is the primary genus of everything. But the most universal of all things is God, and in the second place the Word of God. But other things have an existence only in word, but indeed they are at times equivalent to that which has no existence. 22. 87. See now the difference between him who turns to sin in the desert, and him who sins in Egypt. For the one is bitten by serpents which cause death, that is to say by insatiable pleasures which inflict death, but the other, he who meditates in the wilderness, is only bitten by pleasure, and driven astray, but is not killed. And the one, indeed, is healed by temperance, which is the brazen serpent which was made by the wise Moses, but the other is supplied by God, with a most beautiful draught, to drink, namely, wisdom, from the fountain which he himself has brought forth out of his own wisdom. 88. Nor, indeed, does the pleasure which is in the form of a serpent, abstain from attacking that most sincere lover of God, Moses, for we read, as follows, if, therefore, they will not obey me, nor listen to my voice, for they will say, God has not been seen by you, what shall I say to them? And the Lord said unto Moses, what is that which is in thy hand? And he said, a rod. And God said, cast it on the ground. And he cast it on the ground, and it became a serpent, and Moses fled from it. And the Lord said unto Moses, stretch forth thy hand, and take hold of it by the tail. And having stretched forth his hand, he took hold of it by the tail, and it became a rod in his hand. And the Lord said unto him, that they may believe thee. 26:43-89, how can anyone believe God? If he has learned that all other things are changed, but that he alone is unchangeable. Therefore, God asks of the wise Moses what there is in the practical life of his soul, for the hand is the symbol of action. And he answers, instruction, which he calls a rod. On which account Jacob the supplanter of the passions, says, for, in my staff did I pass over this Jordan. 27:G32:10 period. But Jordan being interpreted means descent. And of the lower, and earthly, and perishable nature, vice, and passion are component parts, and the mind of the ascetic passes over them in the course of its education. For it is too low a notion to explain his saying literally, as if it meant that he crossed the river, holding his staff in his hand. 23:90. Well, therefore, does the God-loving Moses answer. For truly the actions of the virtuous men are supported by education, as by a rod, tranquilizing the disturbances and agitations of the mind. This rod, when cast away, becomes a serpent. very appropriately. For if the soul casts away instruction, it becomes fond of pleasure instead of being fond of virtue. On which account Moses fled from it, for the man who is fond of virtue does flee from passion, and from pleasure. 91. But God did not praise his flight. For it is fitting, indeed, for your mind, before you are made perfect, to meditate flight and escape from the passions, but Moses, that perfect man, ought rather to persevere in his war against them, and to resist them, and to strive against them, otherwise they, relying on their freedom from danger, and on their power, will ascend up to the citadel of the soul, and take it by storm, and will plunder it entirely, like a tyrant. 92. On which account God commanded Moses to take hold of it by the tail, that is to say, let not the hostile and untamable spirit of pleasure terrify you, but with all your power take hold of it, and seize it firmly, and master it. For it will again become a rod instead of a serpent, that is to say, instead of pleasure it will become instruction in your hand. 93. But it will be in your hand, that is in the action of a wise man, which, indeed, is true. But it is impossible to take hold of and to master pleasure, unless the hand be first stretched out, that is to say, unless the soul confesses that all actions and all progress is derived from God, and attributes nothing to himself. Accordingly he, when he saw this serpent, decided to flee from it. But he prepared another principle, that of temperance, which is the brazen serpent, that whosoever was bitten by pleasure, when he looked on temperance, might live a real life. 24. 94. Such a serpent Jacob boasts that Dan is, and he speaks thus, Dan will judge his people, as one of the tribes of Israel. 28. Pound sign GE 49:16 period, and again, let Dan be a serpent in the path, sitting upon the road, biting the heel of the horse, and the rider shall fall backwards, waiting the salvation of the Lord. 29. Pound sign GE 49:17 period. The fifth son of Leah is Issachar, the legitimate son of Jacob. But if the two sons of Zilpah are counted, he is the seventh, but the fifth son of Jacob is Dan, the son of Bilhah, the handmaid of Rachel, and the cause of this we will investigate in the proper place, but concerning Dan we must examine further now. 95. The soul produces two kinds, the one divine, and the other perishable. That which is the better kind it has already conceived, and ends in it, for when the soul was able to confess to God, and to yield everything to him, it was not after that capable of receiving any more valuable possession. On this account she ceased to bring forth, after she had borne Judah, the emblem of the disposition of confessing. 96. And now she begins to form the mortal race. Now the mortal race subsists by imbibing. 4. Like a foundation, the sense of taste is the cause of the duration of animals, but the name Bilhah, being interpreted, means imbibing. From her was born Dan, which name being interpreted means judgment, for this kind distinguishes between the separates immortal from mortal things, therefore he prays that he may become a workman of temperance. But he will not pray for Judah already has the capacity of praying to, and pleasing God. 97. Therefore let Dan, says he, be a serpent in the path. One path is the soul. For as in the roads one may behold a great variety of living beings, inanimate and animate, irrational and rational, good and bad, slaves and free, young and old, male and female, strangers and natural citizens, sick and healthy, mutilated and perfect, so also in the soul there are motions inanimate and imperfect and diseased and slavish and female, and innumerable others of the class of evils, and on the other hand, there are motions which are living, and perfect, and masculine, and free, and healthy, and ripe, and virtuous, and genuine, and really legitimate. 98. Let then the principle of temperance be a serpent in the soul, which makes its advance through all the circumstances of life, and let it sit in the path. But what is the meaning of this expression? The field of virtue is not trodden down, for they are few who walk along it, but that of vice is trodden and worn. And he recommends him here to occupy and to fill, with ambush and stratagem, the well-trodden path of passion and vice, in which the thoughts which are deserters from virtue pass their life. 25. 99. Biting the heel of the horse, very consistently the disposition which shakes the stability of the created and perishable being is called the supplanter, and the passions are compared to a horse, for passion has four legs, as a horse has, and is an impetuous beast, and full of insolence, and by nature a most restive animal. But the reasoning of temperance is wont to bite, and to wound, and to destroy passion. Therefore passion having been tripped up, and having fallen, the horseman will fall backwards. We must comprehend that the horseman who has mounted upon the passions is the mind who falls from the passions when they are reasoned upon closely, and so are supplanted. 100. And it is well figured that the soul does not fall forward, for it must not go before the passions, but rather advance behind them, and behave with moderation. And there is sound learning in what he says here. If the mind, though desirous to act unjustly, comes too late and falls backward, it will not act unjustly, but if, when it is moved onwards to some irrational passion, it does not run forward, but remains behind, it will then receive freedom from the dominion of the passions, which is a most excellent thing. 101. On which account Moses, approving of this backward fall from off the vices, adds further, waiting for the salvation of the Lord. 4. In good truth, he who falls from the passions is saved by God, and remains safe after their operation. May my soul meet with such a fall as this, and may it never afterwards remount upon that horse-like and restive passion, in order that it may await the salvation of God, and attain to happiness. 102. On this account also it was that Moses praised God in his hymn, because the horse and his rider has he thrown into the sea. 30 pound sign, X15 1 period, meaning that he has thrown the four passions, and the miserable mind which is mounted on them, down into ruin as to its affairs, and into the bottomless pit, and this is almost the burden of the whole hymn, to which every other part of it is referred, and indeed that is the truth. For if once a freedom from the passions occupies the soul, it will become perfectly happy. 26. 103. And we must also inquire what is the reason why Jacob says that the rider will fall backward, 31 pound sign GE 49 17 period, and Moses says that the horse and his rider have been thrown into the sea. We must say, therefore, that that which is thrown into the sea is the Egyptian disposition, which indeed flies and escapes under the water, that is to say, under the advance of the passions. But the rider who falls backwards is not one of the persons who loves to yield to the passions, and the proof is that Moses calls the one the horseman, Hippias, and the other the rider. Anabates 104. Now it is the business of the horseman to subdue the horse, and when he resists the rein to make him tractable, but it is the part of the rider to be conveyed wherever the animal carries him. And in the sea it is the office of the pilot to guide the ship, and to keep it straight, and to preserve it in the right course, but it is the part of the sailor to endure all that happens to the ship. And in reference to this, the horseman who subdues the passions is not drowned in the sea, but dismounting from them awaits the salvation of the master. 105. Accordingly, the word of God in Leviticus recommends men to feed on those creeping things which go on 4 feet, and which have legs above their feet, so that they are able to leap with them, 32 pound sign 11:22, among which are the locust, and the attacus, and the acris, 33. These are different kinds of locusts, and in the fourth place the serpent fighter, and every properly, for if pleasure, like a serpent, is an unprofitable and pernicious thing, then the nature which contends against pleasure must be a most profitable and saving thing, and this is temperance. 106. Fight thou then, O my mind, against every passion, and especially against pleasure, for the serpent is the most subtle of all the beasts that are upon the earth, which the Lord God has made. 107. And of all the passions the most mischievous is pleasure. Why so? Because all things are the slaves of pleasure, and because the life of the wicked is governed by pleasure, as by a master. Accordingly, the things which are the efficient causes of pleasure are found to be full of all wickedness, gold, and silver, and glory, and honors, and powers, and the objects of the outward senses, and the mechanical arts, and all other things which cause pleasure, being very various, and all injurious to the soul, and there are no sins without extreme wickedness. 108. Therefore do thou array against it the wisdom which contends with serpents, and struggle in this most glorious struggle, and labor to win the crown in the contest against pleasure, which subdues every one else, winning a noble and glorious crown, such as no assembly of men can confer.